something special, so very special. There's nobody quite like me.
I have a spine.
I have a spine.
It can twist and bend.
It can twist and bend.
Oh, what a miracle.
I have a 1 foot.
I have a 1 foot.
Watch me balance.
Watch me balance.
Oh, what a miracle am I. Oh, what a miracle. Oh, what a miracle. Every little part of me. I'm something special. So very special. There's nobody quite like me. Nobody quite like me.
Songs, prelude music were by our preschool graduates. We had preschool graduations Tuesday and Thursday here in this sanctuary. We invite you to stand. Our hymn is number 836, Joyful, Joyful We Adore Thee. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, you hold together all things in heaven and on earth. In your great mercy, receive the prayers of all your children, and give to all the world the spirit of your truth and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And let us pray for the call committee and its support teams. Gracious God, we give thanks for those who have been appointed to serve on the call committee and its support teams. They are entrusted with the work of discerning a new faith formation director for our congregation. Grant to these men and women wisdom, patience, and the direction of your Holy Spirit, that they may exercise right judgment and so serve you and the mission of your people here. Amen. You may be seated. We often applaud choir with their wonderful music. This Sunday, a special thank you at the end of their music. This is the last Sunday before summer break, and we will miss your presence and music, but we thank you especially for serving us in this wonderful way throughout the year.
Sing Alleluia! Sing Alleluia.
Again, our gratitude and thank you. A great final Easter piece. One announcement before we continue with the reading of scriptures. In the folders, you'll see, they were in the folders last week, again this week, an insert asking you to help us with the membership audit. Our Constitution asks that we do this periodically to get accurate information. And if you fill out that form, if you have any questions, you can ask us about it. But fill out that form. Don't put it in the offering plate or in the back with all the other folders. There is a basket on the Welcome Center table, the counter there. You can place those forms. That'll help us greatly in our ministry, and thank you. We continue with the reading of scriptures.
First reading is from Acts 17, a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. Even as some of our your own poets have said, 'For we too are his offspring.' Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Bless our God, you peoples. Let the sound of praise be heard. God has kept us among the living and has not allowed our feet to slip. Come and listen, all you who believe, and I will tell you what God has done for me. If I had cherished evil in my heart, the Lord would not have heard me. Blessed be God, who has not rejected my prayer, nor withheld unfailing love from me.
Second reading is from 1 Peter chapter 3. Who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer from doing what is good, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated. But in your hearts sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear, so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for his sins once for all, the righteousness for the unrighteous. In order to bring you to God, he was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he also went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey when God waited patiently for the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you. as a removal of dirt from the body, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
From the upper room, Jesus shares these words. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning, I want to share with you the vision of ministry that will be guiding our congregation as we seek to fulfill the mission God has given us. I believe everyone received a copy of the vision statement that was recently adopted by our church council and will, at the annual meeting in January, be shared with the whole of the congregation for formal adoption at that meeting. If you didn't get one of the copies, just hold up your hand. Our ushers will bring a copy to you. We're going to be reading it a little later in the service, so you don't need to worry about reading it right now. Right now, what I want to do is share with you a foundational truth that underlies and leads to this vision statement. And that foundational truth is this. We are an Easter people. We are a resurrection people. We are the living body of Christ. Let me say that again. This time I want you to repeat it after me. We are an Easter people. We're a resurrection people. We are the living body of Christ. If what you have said is not true, then all of this, Christ is risen, he's risen indeed, hallelujah, shouting we do throughout the Easter season, it's just nothing more than a football cheer. Go team. This, what we have proclaimed, is not true. St. Paul's Lutheran Church is just another fine, upstanding religious institution in the community, not much different from any of the civic organizations that gather, pay dues, and give back to the community. Oh, we throw in a little religious rite, maybe. If what we have proclaimed is not true, then we might as well turn out the lights, put out the candles, lock the doors, go home. Because God has moved down the street. However, what we have proclaimed is the truth. We are an Easter people. We are a resurrection people. We are the living body of Christ. God has not moved on down the road to find his church. He's alive here. God is alive here. Consider the scriptures that we have been sharing throughout the Easter season. Jesus, each week, has been inviting us to join him in the upper room along with the other disciples. And in the upper room, he is very intentional about instilling deep in our flesh and blood this fundamental truth about who we are as the body of Christ. And I especially appreciate how he does it. I consider how he does it. You know, he's just got a few weeks before he says goodbye to the disciples in terms of being with them in the flesh, guiding them every step of the way in the ministry. He says, I'm putting it in your hands. I will be with you in a new way, in spirit. And I'm thinking to myself, all right, you're abandoning us, really. I mean, how can we ever be all that you have been without you right here in the flesh? And I love how Jesus does it in the upper room, because he doesn't lean into our anxieties and fears. He doesn't say to Peter, Peter, you're in charge, and by the way, this is how you need to organize the church council. And he doesn't say to Mary Magdalene, thank you for your financial support. You've been great at leading that. I'll put you in charge of stewardship, and by the way, you'll need a finance committee. And he doesn't say, somebody, please take care of the volunteers. And John, you're pretty young. You got the youth ministry, okay? He didn't do that in the upper room. What did he do? He said, come here. Come close to me. Don't linger in the corners or in the back pews. Come close. I mean, really, really close. And then he did this. He held out his hands to them. That first Easter evening, he held out his hands to them and he said, look, you see the wounds? Don't just see, touch them. Look, see the wound? Here, put your hand there. That's what he told Thomas a week later. Put your hand here. Deeper. Don't hurry it. Linger in it. Now, this is not an anatomical way of talking. This is a mystical, spiritual way of helping us understand and experience what Christ is and who we are in Christ. Just a couple of days earlier in the upper room, the night he was betrayed, he said it this way, I am the vine, you are the branches, abide in me, I will abide in you. And in this way, you will draw the life and love from me that will lead to the abundant fruit this world needs. Now, in the upper room, he said it pretty graphically. Here, see the wounds, connect, be grafted into me in this way that you'll draw my life and love that I gave for this world on the cross. You'll draw that from me. We are one, and you will be me. My body in this world. Especially like how Jesus does it, because he decides saying it once is not enough. And that's often the way of Jesus. He says it, and he says, I'm not sure you fully got it, so let me say it again. It's kind of what we do in Holy Communion, right? This is my body given for you. Did you get it? Let me do it again. This is my blood shed for you. He does that in the upper room. He says, touch my wounds. And then we go to sit down again. And he says, no. Come back. Come really close. Come really close. And he gathers them close to him. And John says in the upper room that night, he breathed on us the breath of the Holy Spirit. Breathed on each of us the breath of the Holy Spirit. He's got to hold us close to do that. This is the fundamental truth of who we are and how we experience this grace of God. We are the Easter people. We are the resurrection people. We are Christ incarnate. We're the living body of Christ for this world now. This fundamental truth now gives expression to how we live that out here at St. Paul's in the spirit of ministry and mission to this world. Several years ago when I arrived, one of the early things we did within our church council was discuss what are the priorities that we need to be about in these first years. And some of those priorities were pretty practical kinds of things. Had to get them off the table, like the leaking roof or some of the other administrative needs, or putting in place the kind of plans that will help us have strong financial resource for ministry, the proper staffing for ministry, as well as the ongoing programs of mission and ministry we've been doing. And one of those priorities we set was we want to create a vision statement that takes our mission statement, that one-sentence mission statement, and gives it picture language that we can begin to see and wrap our imagination around, and that will lead us to the kind of planning of ministry to take us into the next stage of our church's history. A vision statement, in other words. We said we would not do that as the first priority, but we would take some time to see what God was up to in our congregation at this time. And as we began to see what God was up to and experience that, we would then take time to capture that on paper. Well, we did that last year. We started that. And this last summer, about 8 months ago, Pastor Steve Meising met with the council and staff on a Saturday morning and early afternoon retreat. He led us in conversation and reflection on our mission statement. In each portion of our mission statement, there were scriptures for us to study, and then some very important questions to answer about how this touches the life of this congregation, and how does this impact the community and world. And we were busy in the conversations, and we were busy writing it down on those big newsprint sheets. And I'm guessing when it was done that afternoon, we had enough newsprint sheets to go from the altar down the aisle and maybe even into the lobby. There was a lot on paper, a lot of important conversation. And then we, in the subsequent months, I began to distill all of that, and those many sheets became just a few. Capturing the gold, capturing the heart of what God was calling us to do. And finally, in April, it was this one sheet that you see. And we've adopted it and said, let this guide us. We're going to try it on for these next months, and at our annual meeting, we'll lift it up again. And perhaps then we can approve it officially as a congregation, our vision statement. Brought along something you may have seen on walls in different places in the church, these panels. The one panel I'm holding here is the mission statement for the child care, and then its vision statement. They completed this about a year and a half ago. This will be joined with two more panels, one containing our mission statement as a congregation, and also then the vision statement that is before you. It will be arranged, and we'll have a frame in the middle that will have a photograph capturing some way an aspect of that vision of ministry. That photograph will change from time to time. I'd like you to look at the vision statement with me. The big, bold, black print, that's our mission statement. St. Paul's is a spiritual home, reading the bold print now, reaching out in Christ, transforming love and grace through bold witness and humble service, faith formation, and dynamic worship. That mission statement captures the three arenas of ministry that make up a church. You could think of them as three interlocking circles arranged like a triangle. Those would be worship, faith formation, mission. That captures the whole of ministry. The vision statement begins, St. Paul's is a spiritual home. God is alive here. That's that fundamental truth, isn't it? God is alive here. That makes church, church. Some years ago, leading the good people at Holy Trinity in Sydney, I had this delightful experience. I shared this story at other times, but it was a powerful experience of what it means to say those words, God is alive here. It was a come and grow with us class, a class for people new to our church, wanting to become part of the congregation. And we had the group we had met for several sessions, and we're closing our final class with this question. Why is it that you want to be part of this congregation? And the adults at the table gave the kind of answers you might expect adults to give. But there was this high schooler, a junior in high school, Ben, and came to him and he just stood tall there at the table. And he said, I want to be a part of this church because God is alive here. I said, hallelujah. Can you say that for yourself? Is that why you are here? Because God is alive here. If you find yourself not quite able to muster up that excitement and joy, do what Jesus does in that upper room. Connect to him. He's holding out his hands to you. He wants to breathe his life-giving spirit on you. God is alive here. We, the people of St. Paul's Lutheran Church, welcome all people to come and experience God's grace and power for a new life in Christ. We provide a safe place to be with God and others, a place not like the world that is so divisive, so abusive of people, so quick to pass judgment. We provide a safe place to be with God and others, so that we might share and explore our faith journeys, pray and worship together, and discover our spiritual gifts for building up the body of Christ and serving others. Reaching out in Christ's transforming love and grace. Answering Jesus' call to follow me, we leave our comfort zones behind and are bold in responding to human needs, sharing the message of Christ's death and resurrection so that others might experience God's extravagant love. This section has a second paragraph. And the second paragraph comes directly from the child care and preschool's mission statement. We want to anchor that important ministry right in the center of our vision statement. We want to wrap the whole of our ministry, the worship, the faith formation, the mission of our church, around our child care and preschool ministry. It is such an important part of mission, not only for our people, but for the community. Over 80% of the children and families participating in these ministries are from the community. And it reads, reaching out with Christ's transforming love to children and parents of our church and community, we offer St. Paul's Christian Child Care and Preschool, place where children will experience the love of Jesus through education, song, play, and prayer. And if you could have been here, as some of us were on Tuesday evening and Thursday evening, when the altar was pushed to the side and this whole area was filled with 3-year-old and 4-year-old preschool graduates. They sang, as you heard those songs, I should have had Eric turn it up about 10 times louder, because that's how they sang it, 10 times louder. It was like lifting the roof off. Oh, what an important ministry. Through bold witness and humble service, because of what Christ has done for us, we go forth to share with others the power of the gospel to change lives. And we ask God to empower us to use our time, talent, and treasure to make great things happen for God's kingdom. Through faith formation, called to make disciples for Jesus, we welcome people of all ages and stages of faith to move from knowing about God to experiencing God's presence in their daily lives. We invite people to discover the joy of a lifelong journey in Christ. And we welcome people to ask questions and discover God's grace and truth so that they may grow in wisdom and faith through dynamic worship. Rejoicing in the Lord always, we invite people through traditional and contemporary expressions of worship and prayer to step into God's space and time so that we might gain a new perspective for our week and go forth with a renewed spirit to serve God. There were a lot of helping hands in the last 8 months creating this vision statement, and I think the best hand of all is God's hand that led us through that process. We believe we are honoring God with this vision statement as we seek to fulfill the mission God has given St. Paul's. Now, one of the dangers of having a vision statement is that it can end up in a beautiful poster on a wall, and about 2 months later, it's just vanished from sight because it's invisible now. We're not paying attention to it. We're just walking on by it. And at our April council meeting, the church council consented to try an important planning process for taking words and bringing them to life in ministry. We're going to do an experiment for the next couple of years. That experiment is we're going to step away from the usual committee structure like stewardship, evangelism, social ministry, youth, education, whatever those may be. I'm talking about the ministry planning teams, not the administrative teams. And we're going to step away from that way of putting ministry into action. And we're going to separate the planning and the doing aspects of the ministry into two different sets of teams. We're going to have three small teams who are especially charged with taking the vision, thinking big, and seeing the big picture of what God may be calling us to do, and giving it strategic, so to speak, strategic expression. And then we're going to have a lot of ministry task teams, and they will express the joys and the passions and the calling that are within this body of people. Sometimes those joys and passions, the desires to serve, will come from the people to the teams that are planning the ministry, and sometimes it'll flow the other way. Right now, our particular committees, this is how it's often experienced. We need to do some stewardship. We'll give that to the stewardship committee. Now we're not so concerned about it. We'll let them be concerned with it. And they have to do the planning and the doing, and now and then they check in with us or ask us to help them. Of course, really, stewardship belongs to the whole of the church, right? Likewise, evangelism. Likewise, any of those important functions. We'll be sharing more of this with you in terms of how the task teams might begin in some of their ministry already. Several of the task teams are in place doing some pretty exciting things. They'll be sharing that with you this summer. But I want to say a special word about the vision planning teams. That's really the new thing. We're going to have three vision planning teams. The teams will be small. Three people, plus a staff person, and they will be assigned, lean into this vision statement. See how God may be calling us to bring it to life in new ways. Our foundation has given us $10,000 to help create new ministry based on this vision. A member of our church has left a beautiful gift. Actually, not a member of our church. His mother died, Craig Wilkins, and he, in honor of his mother, Sarah, gave $5,000. From her estate to him to be used for new ministry. He said, I want you guys to reach people with the gospel. Here's some money to make it happen. Our vision planning teams, small teams, three people for each team, one staff member. The worship vision planning team, senior pastor serving with them, especially concerned with Sunday morning ministries, not just here in the sanctuary, out there in the hospitality and fellowship areas, concerned with the invitations that bring people to worship. The faith formation team, not just traditional programs, but the whole of our faith journey, both here and in our everyday life and homes. The faith formation director assigned to that team. Mission, the mission vision team. That team charged with the care of members and the sharing of that love and that mercy of God with the people of our community, its needs, and the world beyond. The associate pastor with that team. Looking for 9 people, in other words, and a faith formation director. We have to the 2 pastors already. I'm looking for 9 additional people. And these are the qualities I would have you think about. Do I have these qualities? Can I be part of these teams? And if I say yes, what will I be doing? Well, we'll teach you what we're doing. And we'll be exploring your passions and joys. And we'll serve. You'll serve either 1, 2, or 3 years. And then rotate off and someone else will take your place. But these are the qualities we're looking for. Excuse me. These are the qualities we're looking for. Do you have a passion for the ministry of this church and its future? Is there a passion that God has put in your heart for that? Second quality, does the word change and innovation excite you? Or does it make your jaw hit the table thinking, some of us are wired. We just live for change and innovation. I mean, we just live creativity. It doesn't scare us at first. Needing some of those folks on the strategic teams. And the third quality, do you have a heart open and an eye open to seeing where God is pointing and where God may be opening the doors to put mission in place to create the ministry that brings this vision fully, fully to life? If you have those qualities, be praying about it and talk to me. The rest of us, where are your gifts? The gifts God has given you for building up the body of Christ here. Where are your gifts, your time, your talent, your treasure, your prayers? How might they be at work in this? Something for all of us to begin praying about and asking God, show us what you want us to see. Again, we are rooted in that fundamental truth of who we are in Christ. We've been living it and hearing about it throughout this entire Easter season. We draw near to Christ, touch the wounds, feel the breath. We are his Easter people. We are his resurrection people. We are the living body of Christ here at St. Paul's. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand.
Thank you.
Now with the whole church on earth, across continents and across centuries, we confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And rejoicing in the risen life of Christ, we pray for the church, for the world, and for all who are in need. Merciful Father, we pray for your church. Draw your people across denominations together as one. Bring an end to our divisions from one another. Send your Spirit to your people and rouse us to greater love and mission. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the nations that you would give wisdom to all those who govern. Bless especially our elected leaders, our governor, our legislatures, our Congress, and our president. Strengthen all who work and strive for peace. And protect all of those who have been scattered, driven from safety and shelter, who seek your safety and your freedom. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for all who are in need, for those who suffer abuse or neglect, for all who struggle with addiction, and for all those who grieve, and all who are ill. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, bless this assembly. As we move forward, may the vision that we seek to fulfill help us to focus, help us to best utilize the great gifts that you have provided to bring your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Joining our voices with the faithful in every time and place, we offer our prayers in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us take a moment to share the peace of Christ with those around us.
The gratitude we express to choir, we express also to our bell choir, who have shared from time to time through the year the beautiful music of their bells. Again, thank you. Congregation may stand. Join together in the offering prayer. Be known to us, O Lord, in the breaking of the bread, as you were made known to the disciples. Receive these gifts and the offering of our lives, that we may be your risen body. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for the Spirit poured out on all nations. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, in the same manner, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. We join hands as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, may be seated. Now let us feast this Easter day, this Easter celebration on Christ. He is the bread of heaven. Alleluia. Please stand. May this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Together we pray. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection, you sent light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of heaven to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to Jesus' resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world. Through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. May God, who has brought us from death to life, fill you with great joy. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Christ is risen. And you are the body of Christ raised up for the world. Now go in peace and share the good news.